This programming is sponsored by the Bayou Theater at the University of Houston Clear Lake, announcing their new season, featuring a variety of music, dance, theater, and comedy performances. Tickets at uhcl.universitytickets.com.
I see you.
Actor Russell Hornsby has worked nonstop in Hollywood for over two decades. His powerhouse performances include the starring role in the film The Hate U Give, the Netflix drama series 7 Seconds, as well as his role as the family patriarch in the mega-hit Stars series BMF. But he started to notice something. Why was he always playing the black father character?
Once the work got to a place where it demanded more of me, there were blocks, and I had to go back and deal with shit that I hadn't dealt with.
I'm Eddie Robinson. Stay tuned as we bring to you one of the most provocative episodes we've ever produced. ICU welcomes award-winning actor Russell Hornsby. We learn more about his career and why he's become an essential part of the success for many of the projects he's been involved with. Oh yeah, I feel you. We hear you. I see you. This episode contains language that can be offensive to some listeners.
You a policeman now? Because them men need weapons to do their job. What kind of job you got? You need a gun?
It's not like that.
Then what's it like, Demetrius?
A mother's love can only go so far.
You're listening to ICU. I'm your host, Eddie Robinson. And we're extremely fortunate and grateful to have a special guest on the show with us, connecting virtually from Atlanta, award-winning actor Russell Hornsby. Russell, thank you enormously for being a guest on ICU.
Eddie, it is indeed my pleasure, and thank you for having me, brother. I appreciate it.
You know, allow me to fan out a bit because I do love your work. I like to call you a powerhouse performer because there's intensity there. There's strength in the roles that I see you play in. And so allow me to provide you with a plethora of congratulations to my favorite performance that I've seen you in. And I know it's been a while since you've worked on this project, I would imagine. You played the character Isaiah Butler, who's son was fatally killed by an off-duty police officer in a hit and run with 7 Seconds, the Netflix series. All the tension that an incident like this could bring on a family, a black family. And you internalize that so brilliantly. You collaborate in scenes with Regina King, who plays your wife Latrice.
And you never know what happened. And the only one who might ever know is God.
God didn't run my son down in the street and leave him to die.
The tension between you and your brother Seth, played by the British actor Zachary Momoa, the intensity. You know, if you can recall when you played that particular role in 7 Seconds, where did this energy come from?
Eddie, first of all, thank you so much for saying that. I'm very, very proud of that role and the work I did. I think that, you know, that role, that opportunity came soon after Fences. And actually, it was because of Fences that the producers and directors saw that they gave me the opportunity to play Isaiah.
The Denzel Washington directed film Fences.
Yes. And the reality of it is that they say there was a time when boats were made of wood and men were made of steel. And so I think that Isaiah represents and represented that type of man. I believe that he is and was a throwback, a man of another era.
Boys like us don't make it out of here. Bring made that seagull for me. I want it back.
Get out.
What did you say?
I said, get out! Get out! Get out! Get out! Get out! Get out!
Very, very strong-willed, deeply deep in his faith. But see, what oftentimes we don't really assess and look at is that in this culture, in our society, that the black man is muted. And so he has to suppress a lot of that strength and a lot of that energy. That's why when the show opens, you see him, his freedom ringing comes out when he's in the church, right?
I'm gonna fly away. I'll fly away.
He's singing hallelujah. He's playing the piano, and he's allowing himself to feel the spirit within him, right? And that's allowing him to sort of lift every voice and sing out and praise, right? And then so, but then we see that once he's outside of that, there is a quiet that comes about him. There is, you know what I mean? And that quiet, I think, represents, that's like since you said that, that dream deferred. And that represents that dream deferred in a lot of men, right? And so a lot of Black men did not get the opportunities, didn't reach the heights that they had set for themselves, right? And so what Isaiah does is he walks around subdued because he's not where he is, I believe. He's not doing what he loves, I believe. And so when you reach a certain age in life, that reality sets in. And it suppresses your energy. It suppresses your liveliness. It suppresses a lot of things. And you just get quiet. Why? Because there's nothing more to say. You know, when we were young and we were kids coming up, people always ask, hey, man, what are you doing? What are you trying to do? What do you want to be? And you're able to say those things because it's all about the possibility. It's all about what you're looking forward to doing when you're in your youth and you're pre-35, even pre-40. You have all this vim and this vigor of like the potential. And that potential puts a smile on your face. That potential gives you energy. It livens you, right? With your friends, with your family members, because you're able to explain with so much love and joy what I want to be. And so you say to yourself, you know what? I'm going to take this job working for the city. A little hustle job, a little side job. I'm going to take this job working in public works. Because you know what? It's just, hey, I'm going to get these little benefits. But you know, I'm going to start this business. I'm going to do thus and so. I'm going to take this job as a sanitation worker, as a mailman. Right? Because it's temporary. Because I'm about to make some things happen. But then life sets in. You know, the house gets purchased. The kids are born. There is an illness in the family. You know, something happens, you need the roof leaks. And so you have to find a way now. I gotta pay for this stuff. So what happens? Now I get further and further behind. So now that job that was supposed to be temporary, and it was for Isaiah working in a chicken coop or in a, you know, where they slaughter goats and animals and whatnot, that becomes your mainstay. And you wake up one morning at 40, 45 years old, and you realize this is my reality now, and that hurts. And so you realize all of the dreams of yesterday have evaporated, and so now you're living in the reality of today, and it ain't pretty. And I think that is what a lot of people, of course, and in our culture, Black women, men and women, but I'm a Black man, so I'm gonna speak for me and my people.
There you go.
And my kind, that dream was deferred and that opportunity lost. And so therefore I got nothing to say. All I can do is go to work and come home. And that's when you see Black men in these cities and in these streets, there is just a calm about them. There's nothing to do. There's nothing to say. Hey, man, how you doing, brother? And what do we do? The rhetoric, man, you know, just surviving, making it happen, baby. Just trying to, you know, just going to work. You know how it is, brother. It's all good, baby. The rhetoric, it's a record on repeat because there's nothing else to say. And so when I take Isaiah, I'm saying it. I had to take that energy of the men that I knew, of the men that helped raise me, and the sacrifices that these men made for their families, sometimes unfairly. And then you see the pain in their eyes because it didn't happen. I hear their stories. Now tell me about what didn't happen. This is when I was in my 20s and 30s, when they would say, yo, young blood, you need to go out there and, man, just follow your dreams, young blood. Do what you gotta do, man, make it happen. Don't settle, young blood. You go, all right, man, what's that for? No. Don't let nobody tell you this, you know what I mean? So that's Isaiah. I'm sorry, and I'm, you know what I mean?
Jeez.
That's who he is. That's the character. That's the man. And then, you know, when all these things are happening to his son and happening to his family, and he says it in episode 6, I'm just tired of it all.
Yeah, that work out. Keeping you off the streets. Keeping my son off the streets. I'm tired of it all. Kind of beat down to the bone. You know what I'm saying?
And I'll let you in on something. That line touched me so because I was raised by a single mother. And that was the line she would say sitting on the couch, having to pay bills with no money. And she would, with tears and emotion as I have now, she would just say, I'm just tired. I remember that. So when that line, I saw that line, that took me back to when I was in my early teens, late, you know, 10 to 13 or whatever, and my mom's trying to rob Peter to pay the poor. And I now understand what tired is. Mom, I'm tired. You don't have the energy to fight. People don't have the energy to get up. So that's part of the colorization and the characterizations that I brought to Isaiah and that I was able to build on throughout the whole 10 episodes of the series. And I think what makes it palpable, and that's what I bring, that's the energy that I bring. The energy is the truth. The energy stems from truth. There is no right nor wrong. There is only truth. And so me as an actor, my energy comes from the truth within the people that I meet, that I see. The men, the women, our kinds of people, I am representing them. My story is a representation, is a reflection of the people in the street, the people in the neighborhood, the people that help. As Cornel West often says, at times, the least of these. That's who my work represents. Our everyday people. And Sly and the Family Stone speaks to our everyday people.
Coming up, we continue our chat with actor Russell Hornsby. We dive deeper into his experiences of being an actor in Hollywood and what it means for him to be a Black actor in Hollywood. We learn the difference. Plus, has he ever felt locked into playing certain roles and characters on screen? I'm Eddie Robinson, a fascinating conversation about Black representation in film and television when ICU returns in just a moment. If you're enjoying this episode, The Souls of Russell Hornsby, be sure to subscribe to our podcast, ICU with Eddie Robinson. You can hear all the past episodes and be notified when new episodes are released. Also, take a minute to give us a review or comment. We love getting feedback from our listeners. This is ICU. I'm your host, Eddie Robinson, and we're so grateful to have with us theatrical TV and film actor Russell Hornsby. He's earned a nomination for 2023 NAACP Image Award for his portrayal of the infamous boxing promoter Don King in the Hulu limited series Mike. He's also known as the Patriarch Father in the Starz hit series BMF, which stands for Black Mafia Family, a crime drama series created by rapper 50 Cent TV writer Randy Huggins. Despite Russell being a fan favorite, he'll share with us later in this episode a shocking revelation related to his involvement with BMF. We're chatting with him virtually on his computer from Atlanta, Georgia. Your roles really get intense. And you speak for so many of us through your powerful performances. It's your emotion, the family fights that you find yourself in at times, the right. arguments, the love, the passion for trying to make ends meet for the family.
Thanks. I was just in the neighborhood. Thought I'd stop by for a minute.
Yeah, you was in the neighborhood, all right. You telling the truth there. You was in the neighborhood because it's my payday.
Well, hell, since you mentioned it, let me have $10.
I'll be damned. I'll die and go to hell and play blackjack with the devil before I give you $10.
That's what I want to know about that devil you done seen.
Pop done seen the devil. You too much,
yeah,
Pop.
Yeah, I done seen him.
He ain't seen
him
no
too.
Devil. I told him that man ain't had nothing to do with the devil. Anything he can't understand, he want to call it the devil.
These performances shine for many of us. And so with that being said, thank you. Thank you for your craft. Thank you for what you do. And the reason why I get teary-eyed about all of this is because we don't have these kinds of conversations about Black men mm-hmm. and what Black men are going through in this day and age. How did you get into acting? What was it about acting that pushed you to study it and wanted to be immersed into it?
I come from a long line of personalities, you know, not necessarily actors in the professional standpoint or even the craft standpoint, but just personalities in my family. My mother is a personality. My uncles are personalities, you know, telling jokes, life of the party, animated conversations and arguments and things of that nature. And so that energy was always in me. You know, you're doing little plays in elementary school and then you're in the school plays in high school and whatnot. And I'll be honest with you, I was doing the school plays. I did The Wiz, I did Guys and Dolls, you know, Godspell, Grease, you know, whatever. And they were pretty much all musicals, even though I can't really sing. So we're in homeroom class and we're all trying to decide, you know, hey, what do we want to go major in? What do we want to do? And my friend, I'll never forget this. A friend, Jason Dillard, said, hey, man, why don't you do that acting? They don't do nothing. And like me, in my infinite wisdom, I was like, they don't do shit. Like, yeah, acting is easy. And so I literally, at that moment, I applied to go to theater school. And I applied to NYU and Boston University. When you go to audition for the school, NYU and North Carolina School for the Arts were there. And so that, so before BU said, hey, why don't you just come over and audition for us? So I went over audition for them, got into, on the spot, both NYU and North Carolina University offered me entry right on the spot. You know, it was one of those, I was, you know, they were being affirmative.
Exactly. Got it. Got it.
But I ended up getting into Boston University and my family's from Boston. Awesome. And so I figured it is like a home away from home. I didn't know North Carolina and I knew New York. So I was like the middle thing of the city and the country kind of thing.
Sure.
Then I went to Boston University, studied, and like my mother said, you can do this, but you can't quit. And so I went after my freshman year, I wanted to leave, but in the back of my mind, my mom said, like, you can't quit. And you know, that mother wit, that mother love, like it scares you at 18, 19 years old, you're still scared.
Sure.
So I finished and I caught that, like, I found myself when I was doing theater. Like, you know, I had some place for my emotions to go. I had some place for my pain to go, for my fears to go, quite honestly. Unbeknownst to myself, it became cathartic. It became therapeutic and not really knowing. And then, so, you know, you go to New York and you're just hunting, just trying to get jobs and everything like that. And I believe I found myself when I started doing August Wilson. Because see, the thing was, is that as a Black actor, it's funny how theater school, especially as a Black actor, they strip you they stripped me a lot of my essence at the time. You know, I didn't realize it, but they didn't build me back up. Mm. You know, I came in all soulful and talking up the side of my neck and reciting Tupac and, you know, talking like, you know, I was just colored black. Like, what's up? You know what I mean? Saying nigga all the time, woo, 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 you know what I mean? And then they slowly strip you of that. So now you're standard American English and learning all these dialects and things of that nature and finding that theatrical resonance and all of that. So I'm walking around resonant, constantly, sounding like Keith David. Like, you know, hey, hey, hey. And I remember I auditioned for New York Undercover. And it was, you know, one of them drug dealers, you know, all that kind of stuff like that. So I go in there, and I'm a drug dealer from the left. I go in there sounding like, hey, brother, what's up? What you want? You know, nickel bag of funk, what you need? You know what I mean? And they said, you know this is a drug dealer, right? I was like, yes. They said, well, you know this is a drug dealer in Harlem. Yes, I'm aware of that. They go, thank you very much.
Interesting. And I'm wondering, did that concern you, them stripping away the essence, right, of who you are? I mean, did that concern you at any in terms of this profession, of what you're getting ready to get into?
No, you know what, Eddie? I was too dumb to know. And again, ignorance, it could be bliss, but it could also be painful. And I just didn't know. And so once I found August Wilson, I found the theatrical colored section.
There you go.
I found the theatrical rhythm section. You know what I mean? And so I found myself again. And then I found, and I was around other brothers. I was around black men who were 20 years my senior, and just their moves and their vibes. And then you saw the way they were able to basically, in a sense, code switch, if you will. And so I learned that. And then it took me all that time to get me back into my black DNA, to get my rhythms back, to get my soulfulness back. And then in terms of how do I put it into a performance? And, you know, like I could be black, like with my people, but then I didn't understand how do I craft it into the work? How do I put this blackness into this work where instead of being this, being presentational. Where's Russell at? Oh, it took a little minute. Oh, I got it. So now I'm able to go on all these auditions and it's like, wow, you're interesting. Like you got a way about you. That's, it ain't whitewashed and it ain't ish. It's like, it's perfectly placed so within the context of intellectual, within the context of standard speech, within the context of being able to project black educated authenticity. I go, okay, this will work. And then I was able to slide some oil to it at the same time where it was just like, oh, wow. And then you get that authenticity.
There it is, as an actor.
But again, that takes a little time. And you have to be, as we say, a student of the world, right? You have to allow your culture, you have to allow the world, your people to envelop you and get inside. And that's what I did. And so that was kind of the cliff noted journey to the sort of the present, if you will.
Right, of how you got here today.
Yeah.
I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're here with BMF actor Russell Hornsby on ICU. He's in Atlanta, joining us virtually from his computer. Over the course of black actors being a part of Hollywood, there have been instances where, you know, typecasting occurs. Mm-hmm. Some actors have been found, you know, they've found it challenging to break into roles, or even actors like Idris Elba recently,
right,
who have decided that they no longer want to be considered a black actor so as to not limit the roles that they receive. Have you ever had an instance where you felt typecast?
Honestly, no. And I'll tell you because, and see, here's the thing. I think that we're getting more opportunities now than we did 20 and 30 years ago. You know what I mean? Or more of us are getting opportunities, right? Collectively than we were 20, 30 years. That, and that's just progress. I think that my first major role was playing a doctor on television. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I'm a series regular on an ABC show. I'm playing a black doctor, bespectacled, with hair like this that was even longer, and it was nappy. They let me roll. They didn't say cut it. They didn't say get your, you know, cut it down, shave it off. They just said they let me roll with it. I was like, okay. And honestly, up until probably fences. Mm-hmm. I'm playing primarily what you might call mainstream roles. I'm a black man playing mainstream roles. I'm playing a doctor, playing a lawyer, I'm playing a police officer, you know what I mean? And then Fences was like the first time I was like soulful. And I think that that's what changed people's idea of me.
Interesting.
Because I think that they saw me as a good actor. Like, oh man, he's got presence on screen, he's a good actor, he's come straight-laced. Just the facts, ma'am. You know, deep vein thrombosis, you know, triple CCs of this, all that kind of stuff. He can elocute what we need, right? Because, and again, that's representative of me going to theater school, right? So I can play down the line, right? I got all that. Then when I come in Fences, and I think this is whites and blacks, I think then they saw, oh, this is cultural specificity, and he's rocking with D and Vi? Oh no, Russell Hornsby's a man. And I had all that soulful in me because I was doing August Wilson on stage. I'm black, I'm, you know what I mean? Hey, what's up? I got to dance at the parties and do all that. Hey, what's up, baby? But I think for the first time, Hollywood and black culture saw me in that for real for the first time. Then you look at me working opposite Soul Sister number one, Regina King, in 7 seconds. They go, ooh, this dude, he backing up with Regina King now? Ow! Then you come and then you go, so then you go to the Hate You Give. Oh, he can play a gangster too? Ow! What can't you do, brother?
There you go.
So I didn't come into the black side of the, you know, the rhythm section until post 40. They didn't think I was black. If you understand what I'm saying, you know what I mean? Like, soulfully black.
Correct.
They didn't think pardon my French, I'm saying it, I've come up from it. They didn't think I was a So when you're doing all this, they go, man, we got some parts for you now, brother.
That's interesting. I'm curious if you can share with us a moment, an incident, and perhaps it's even triggering, that dances around in your head as the most racist situation or incident that you could have ever experienced, and it still resonates with you even now.
I'll remove the names to protect the guilty.
You can, but you know.
But I was doing a show, and I was number two on the call sheet.
Okay.
And so I had this passion to direct. And so I had begun to shadow directors just on my own. I had begun to create shot lists and talk to the directors about thus and so, thus and so. And so I went to one of the producers and I said, hey, I would like to direct. And the producer said, hey, man, you know, we got you. No problem. So he went up the ladder and he went to the studio and they said, hey, Russell would like to direct. And the studio was basically like, hey, we're all for it as long as the showrunners agree. These gentlemen were older and pale. And so they asked me to dinner. And I go, hey, Russ, you want to go to dinner? We're going to take you to dinner. I said, okay, great. So we sit down, exchange pleasantries. And they said, hey, Russell. I mean, before, I think the water had just landed. And they said, Russell, are you happy? I said, yes, I'm very happy to be here. This is great. It's good, because if anybody's not happy, we can give them a beautiful death. And then the following season, number one was directing. And that was the longest dinner I'd ever been on, ever. And it was never brought up, never acknowledged. It was just stated, if you're not happy, you can leave. And I couldn't get out of that mother jumper fast enough. And now that I'm gone and I'm successful, they have since kind of come back around and said, hey, let's try to do a project together. And I go, hey guys, if your phone don't ring, you know it's me. And the thing is, you know, you gotta take the crooked with the straight. So I understand now why people say, our brothers and sisters have said over the years, you can't play the victim card. I'm mad. It upsets me. It pains me. But my mother used to always said is nothing, you know, the best revenge is doing well. So you see me, you know what you did, you know what happened, and it's still I rise, right? So I have to roll with that and keep going, you know what I mean? And, you know, there have been other little things that have happened to me over the years that you just kind of, it's interesting. And here's the other thing too. And I said to somebody, when I started that job, I didn't realize how cliquish things were in Hollywood, you know what I mean? And I had also done, you know, a lot of jobs where I was, see, I don't understand. I got into the game at 24. So relatively young, right? So you're still considered a boy. And then when you pass that 35-year-old threshold or whatever, or 30 to 35-year-old threshold, I didn't realize that the shift comes where people don't embrace you the same way when you're a man. People pick sides, they have camps. And so early on, I said, I'll never forget, I called my friend and I said, man, I had been on the job about a month and, you know, I wasn't getting invited initially to the dinners on the weekends. You know, they would come down, they would come back from the weekends, hey man, that was a great dinner, man, we should do that again. Oh man, drinks were great, man, we should do that again. I'm like, wow. I didn't get invited, nobody gave me a call, you know what I'm saying? And I called a buddy and I said, man, I said, I feel like a n*** for the first time in my life. And that was what it was. It was like, oh, this is growing older in the business and being a man in it. And oh, now, no, I'm a black man now. I'm a black man now. I'm not a black boy. Where it's like, hey, everybody, we can all play together. Let's, you know what I mean? Just like they talk about in slavery time, you know what I mean? Like, you play the boys, white boys and black boys played together till about 12.
Sure.
Then they said, all right, you go ahead, take your ass out in the fields, and you, Billy, you make sure that doing that too. It was kind of that.
Coming up, we wrap up our chat with the award-winning actor, Russell Hornsby. We'll turn our attention to one of the hottest shows on TV right now, the mega-hit Starz series, BMF, the crime drama inspired by the true story of two brothers who rose from the tumultuous streets of Detroit in the late 80s to usher in the birth of a black mafia family unit. Does this series glamorize a drug culture of making money and a so-called gangsta lifestyle? Or are there bigger interpretations at play? And how does Russell feel about young actors of today? What's missing in their talent? I'm Eddie Robinson. You do not want to miss our final segment of ICU. We'll be right back in just a moment. If you're enjoying this episode, The Souls of Russell Hornsby, be sure to subscribe to our podcast, ICU with Eddie Robinson. You can hear all the past episodes and be notified when new episodes are released. Also, take a minute to give us a review or comment. We love getting feedback from our listeners. It's ICU. I'm your host, Eddie Robinson, and we're so grateful to have with us multi-talented actor Russell Hornsby. He's a man that's worked nonstop in Hollywood for over two decades. And the roles that he's played, the characters he's portrayed, the energy that he brings to the screen and on stage speak volumes to his undeniable strength and powerful presence as an actor. You know, you've had a banner year with critics saying you've delivered the performance of a lifetime as this crazy infamous boxing promoter Don King in the Hulu limited series Mike.
The minute you get too big, they gotta cut you down.
And you've also garnered a nominated 2023 NAACP Image Award. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
And people know you as Eddie Sutton.
Yes.
ABC's Lincoln Heights.
You know, everybody tells me I can talk, but sometimes you gotta do, or all you are is talk.
the detective in the NBC series Grimm.
Yes.
The Hate U Give, of course, was a remarkable series that you were part of.
Thank you.
When you're ready to talk, you talk. Don't ever let nobody make you be quiet.
But it's your role as the patriarch.
Mm-hmm.
Charles Flannery in the mega hit stars series BMF.
Life is hard enough as is, especially if you're a black man in this country. And it's even harder when you're uneducated like me. I don't want you to have to go through the same struggle I had to endure.
BMF is one of the top shows on Stars and ranked as the most socially engaged drama across all networks. Did you have any second thoughts of picking up this role? How were you approached
I didn't want to do it.
Really?
I'll tell you, I was tired of playing fathers.
In my mind, I'm thinking to myself, I bet Russell Hornsby didn't want to play this role.
No, I didn't. And my dear friend, Tasha Smith, had to convince me. She said, Russell, I need you. We need you. She said, you're the first person I'm coming to with this. I need you for this. This is going to be an important show. And I said, I want to work it from the family. And I was sitting there going, well, you know, man, I'm tired of playing fathers and there's not a lot to do and this, that, and the third. And then I spoke with the showrunner, the creator, and Randy Huggins. Mm. And he kind of convinced me. He said, nah, man, we need... He said, listen, man, I never even thought I could get a Russell Hornsby. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is what he said. He's like, bro, if you come aboard, he said, if you come on board, we're going to enhance this. And to his credit, and he did. But what I realized, Eddie, is that... And what became... the sort of the moment of truth, I realized at my age at that time, it's my turn to now take the focus off of myself. And I mean, I'm going to work more and more. I got years to go before it's all said and done, but it's time for me to lift as I climb. It's time for me to give back. And I said to myself, we're going to be working with these younger actors that may not have the experience or the talent level. And I've realized I could be a leader both on screen and off screen, quite honestly. And me and Tasha talked about that ad nauseum over lunches and dinners. And I said to them, and again, to their credit, I said, I'm saying this respectfully, and I'm saying this with coming to you in huge humility. I said, I think that I should be number one on the call sheet. At least for the first season, I said, because I believe that it'll set a precedent that this is the guy we got and he's our leader. And I said, it'll give me the power to lead. And they said, you know what? And they had to go to Stars with it. They said, you know what? You're right. And they did that. And I had the sort of the power of being the number one to come in there and lead with love and lead with respect. And pull guys' coats and check young brothers every once in a while. And then we all grew together. The rising tide lifted all boats. And I think that we have a wonderful family because of that. And I want to say, you know, I kind of, you know, the whole thing about the angry father, the patriarch moniker, I think that it's misplaced. And I think what people, and especially audiences of today, I think a lot of families, a lot of people, a lot of young people aren't used to seeing men in the house. Mm-hmm. They're not used to seeing fathers at home. And so what this man, what this father, what this patriarch is saying, that this is my house and I'm not standing for no bullshit, boy. And so, you know, in that time when boats were made of wood and men were made of steel, when at my house, I'm the king. So no, I'm a talk to you some kind of way because obviously you don't get it. And so as the old folks used to say, I'll give you sugar for sugar and salt for salt. If you can't get along with me, it's your own damn fault. And see, these young folks don't get it. They don't understand. And see, that's what I'm saying when I mean the black man has been subdued. He's been muted. So I can't tell my knucklehead boys who think that they grown, sit your ass down. That's parenting. That's loving. I'm not supposed to sit up here when you 14, 15, 16, 17 years old and say, please, honey, please, boy, bit these big old muscles and shit. Like, hey, will you stop that? If you don't mind, will you stop selling drugs? If you don't mind, will you not bring these firearms in my house? It's okay. See, that's what mothers do. Fathers parent, and they say to men, if you come in me with this bullshit, I'm gonna fuck you up. Now, if everything's cool, hey, son, you want to go out shoot some hoops? Yeah, dad. Hey, son, you want to go to the ball game? Yeah, dad. Hey, man, you want to go take a ride? Yeah, dad. All right. Hey, man, let's go take a ride. Boy, come on, man. All right. When you're doing the right thing, I'll give you sugar for sugar and salt for salt.
The power of your performance speaks volumes when we hear of news about fans of the Starz show threatening to switch off and boycott the show because apparently you've committed adultery.
Yeah.
We won't spill anything in case someone wants to check out the series, right. But we're not going to spill the tea, but you've worked with this actress before, Breonna White before, and that likely explains the chemistry the two of you have in BMF. Yeah. But it speaks volumes to me, and if you can speak on this, as relates to the power that you bring to this character and how incredible your acting is, because the fans are all over the place, mad and upset with you that you've cheated on.
But see, this is the problem with where we are in our culture and our society now. Everybody is so, what do we call it? Everybody's so f***ing sensitive. This is life. You think this shit didn't happen back in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s? You think this shit don't happen today? It's called life. People fight. They fall out like teeth in gums. This shit happens. So why don't, instead of getting all in your feelings and getting all triggered and shit, look at what's happening in the world. Look at what happens in our culture. Look at what happens in our society. Why are mother jumpers worried about me being mad about taking my son's money and worried about the motherfuckers shouldn't be dealing drugs in the first place? Feel that pressure. But we want to get it mixed up because our values are f***ed. Pardon me. We're getting it mixed up. So that you're gonna get mad at this dad because he has integrity. Because he's saying, stop dealing drugs. No, I'm not taking your money. I'd rather die. I'd rather that roof fall in before I take your money that you got in illicit dealings. Oh, but so now, because we don't have any integrity, because father's been gone, and so fathers have been out of the home and haven't been there to hold a standard, to hold you young mother jumpers in check, to say no. You get it mixed up that the father's wrong? Mm. Oh, no. Y'all kids are tripping.
And before we get off of BMF, I do want to ask you this. You know, the success of the show, does it concern you? I mean, I recall the early 90s when the film New Jack City entered the arena.
This is big business. This is the American way.
My friends and I went crazy and we wanted Nino Brown dead.
That's right.
You know, spoiler alert. But the audience was in an uproar at the end of the film. But it did in some manner, glamorize this crime-infested lifestyle, Al Pacino Scarface. With the influence of that film in and of itself and why it's so popular in the hip hop community. What does the success and popularity of BMF say about Black Americans? Perhaps the lack of generational wealth? Or am I thinking about this too hard and I need to go somewhere and drink a glass of water?
No. It's not that. I think that what it is, I feel that it's the response that, it's how people are viewing it, I think, that is skewed. See, everybody's looking at the glamorization of the drugs and everything like that. We're not looking at the system that propagated it. We're not looking at Detroit being a broken city. We're not looking at the broken state of Michigan. We're not looking at the broken country in the 80s that came up by Reaganomics. Where people, see, that came out from the 70s when all these factory jobs were lost. When they came out in the 70s, when they stopped putting home ec, when they stopped putting wood shop, when they stopped putting manufacturing in the public schools where black men could get jobs. So you take all that opportunity away, right? Out of the school. So then you take, and so now these men who used to work with their hands, right? When boats were made of wood and men were made of steel, they can no longer have a viable place to learn a craft, to learn a trade. So then you take all the industry out of the inner city. Now they got no place to work. This is all in the 70s. So then when the 80s come, the jobs are getting fewer and fewer. There's no factory jobs, right? So now what do? You push the crack in, baby. Got him. So you leave the man, the father, defenseless. You leave him with no way to support his family. And then in the 90s, we got the prison industrial complex. Oh, see, that's the problem with our audiences, with our culture. You paying attention to the wrong thing. And again, I use the profanity to emphasize.
I think if you put 10 people in a room and they're all familiar with your work, each person in that room would likely mention a different production, a different film, a different series that you were a part of that they'd love. What's been the most profound character you've ever portrayed of all the roles, either on stage or on TV, on film? What's been the role you've been the most proud of and why?
So I would give you one from stage, one from screen. So from stage, it was August Wilson's King Headley II, where I played the lead King Headley in New York at the Signature Theater in 2007. It was the first time that I was the definitive lead. It was the first time I think that the theater audiences in New York got a chance to see. It was my coming out party, actorially. And so people got a chance to see that. I was able to make a grand statement. Also, I had gone to TV, and so I had been gone for a moment. And it also let audiences know that I still got it. So then I think for television film, I think it was The Hate U Give. It was playing Maverick Carter. And why that was is because it was the first time, I believe, that I had a character arc on camera. Like in the film, like a real character arc, beginning, middle, and end.
We want an immediate end to police brutality.
Finish it.
And the murder of black people and people of color and oppressed people.
By what means?
By any means necessary.
By what means?
By any means necessary.
By what means?
By any means necessary.
So why are you gonna be quiet?
And so I had to sit home. I had the time to really sit home and craft my performance. See, when you're dealing with television, you know, you're just working from script to script to script, and you don't have it all together to craft the work. You just gotta take what you got in front of you, work this, and then, okay, in 3 weeks, I'm gonna know what's coming next. Oh, we're doing this now. Do you know what I mean? There's no arc in the storytelling that, as an actor, I know how I'm gonna build this character, right? So I was able to do that in The Hate U Give, and able to, the first time I was able to transform and play a character, not just behave on film. Do you know what I mean? Like there was, like I had to transform my body. I had to transform the way I walked. I had to change my posture, all this kind of stuff like that. And that was me showing the world and showing Hollywood that I'm a bad mother. That, you know, like I can get down. You know what I mean? So those are the two, yeah.
I'm Eddie Robinson, and we're here with BMF actor Russell Hornsby on ICU. Be sure to follow us on Instagram for clips of our chat with the award-winning actor as we're chatting with him virtually on his computer from Atlanta, Georgia. Of all the accomplishments, an award-winning actor, the remarkable television and film projects you've been affiliated with, Russell Hornsby, what lessons have you learned about yourself thus far?
I heard this a long time ago, but it's only in the last 3 years that I've been able to understand it and honestly, or I think 4 years, and truthfully put it in practice. And that is, dear friend, a mentor, Ren Brown, He told me that an old actor told him that you can't lie in life and tell the truth on stage. And what I understood about that, and what I've now understand, is that you have to be right with yourself. And as I got older, and as the roles got more complicated, I realized I wasn't right. I wasn't right with my past. I wasn't right with my childhood. I wasn't right with who I was up to that point, and I was able to mask it through the work. But once the work got to a place where it demanded more of me, there were blocks. And I had to go back and deal with shit that I hadn't dealt with to be able to come out on the other side, to be able to blossom and bloom for real. And as we all say, I'm still a work in progress, but I'm trying to be more honest and truthful with who I am and what I've done, both good and bad, both positive and negative, some of my missteps, you know what I mean? And so that I can portray and put forth an honest depiction of this character that stems from me. Right? It's a part of me. Every character I play, there's something in me that resides in me that allows me to play that character. And if I have those blocks, or I haven't done that work, I'm lying, because I've been lying to myself. And so that truth comes out of the truth that I'm putting on stage is the truth that I'm dealing with and being honest about myself in my life. And that's been the biggest sort of revelation for me. You know, and we talk about, I go to therapy. You know, me and my wife have a greater communication, because I had to be honest with her about what I have been dealing with and what's going on. And so there's a greater sense of empathy I feel from her. And it's been that. And, I'm trying to walk with a greater sense of self that I don't think was really there. You know, I'll leave with this.
Yes.
Nicole Brianna White, who we worked on Jitney together back in the day, on August Wilson's Jitney. That's where we met. That's where we worked. And I was this loud and boisterous peacock. And we had been working together almost 2 years. And we were at the Second Stage Theater in New York doing Jitney. It's just something I said or something I did. And she came up and she looked at me. She said, "Boy, you are so transparent." And I didn't understand what that meant at the time. But then as I got older, started getting older, I realized, again, I'm not truthful. I'm not honest. She could see right through my bullshit. And I told her that years ago when we got, I said, "Remember you said that?" She's like, "I don't even remember that shit. You know, you was crazy though. You was crazy. And she's even said now how she appreciates my maturity and things of that nature. But she's like, "Yeah, no, you was crazy." So, you know. And I think that's, you know what it is? I think that a lot of us, the young actors, I think a lot of them will get better when they find themselves. And see, the problem is that a lot of these actors, they don't fare well because they're not giving an opportunity to grow. And I think that they're given the keys to the kingdom too young. There is no mentorship anymore. We don't support actors coming from the theater anymore, where you got that work, that mentorship, where if you do 4 years on the stage from 22 to even 26, how much experience you get so that when you transition over to television at 26, 27, 28 with the movies, and I'll be honest with you, in my opinion, I think that's why a lot of the Brits are coming over here and kicking ass, because they get the training. And I believe that they've embraced this new generation, these younger British actors, brothers and sisters, they've embraced their blackness in a way I don't think they did in the past. Because I think through hip hop, through the movies that were come over there, they've taken it on, and I think they've realized they say they're black. They don't say I'm British. Those actors, see, I think before I'm a British actor. I'm a British actor. I mean, you know, I come from the stage and things of that nature. So, you know, no, I feel a little bit better than you. And they were posh and things of that, right? So it didn't translate on the screen the same way. It wasn't as authentic, right? But Once they now you look at Idris, once they sort of they take it on and they go, I'm black man. See? And so and the training allows them to work the dialect and things of that nature because they got the training. But they embrace the cultural specificity of what it is to be black in this. So there's no disconnect. And I think a lot of the, and so for a time, a lot of the American black actors started, and this is the thing. I don't want to be black, I'm an actor. So, no, where's your cultural specificity? Where's the rhythm? Where's the soulfulness? What do they say up in the rhythm section where a nickel costs a dime? Where is that knowledge of collard greens and cornbread? You know what I'm saying? Like all that, that funk. That's black people. When you try to remove that, you remove the essence of who we are, where we come from. We come from struggle. We come from soul food. We come from pig's feet and shit. And that, and then that gives us, so where is your blues? We all got the blues, we niggas. Don't try to act like you can remove it. Because you went to some ivory tower university. Because you got a couple dollars. And see, that's why black folks love Power, BMF, Ghost, yeah. All these shows, because that's of the rhythm. Black people want to see themselves in all of that thing we do. That specialness we got. When you try to remove that, they go, oh, nah, man, now you acting white, bro. I ain't feeling that. That's why Denzel was so good. He's one of the greatest actors because, again, he could be straight-laced, everything, but you still knew that that was a brother. He didn't deny himself. He didn't deny his people. He didn't deny his culture. His walk, his mannerisms, that D-walk, that soulfulness. And see, that's why white folks came up to Harlem to belly rub with n****s. Because they wanted that. When you take that, when you extract that out of the work, you ain't special no more. Audiences say, if you're going to do that, I got a dime a dozen people over here that can do that. I don't need that. Where's the specialness we like? Oh, I got some of that. Why? That's why they listen to our music. That's why they love our food. That's why they love us. That's why they want to kick it and diss. I'm, you know what I mean? So,
that's it.
And so when you embrace that, that's the cultural specificity. That's what sells. That thing that y'all do, that specialness that's in black people, that's what sells worldwide from America. The American black is special. America black is special all over the world because we got that thing that they like.
Will we get our due?
We're getting it. It's no, the due is here. What do you do with it? I mean, listen, what Tyler Perry was able to do, what Ava DuVernay is able to do, what Lena Waithe is able to do, what 50 Cent is able to do, you know, Kenya Barris. I mean, the list goes on. What are you talking? We're doing it.
There you go.
But again, everything is steps. And I think we have to be, here's the thing. This is, see, when we talk about getting our due, we're getting it. But I think that what creatives don't understand sometimes is that, and Stephen, I'm quoting Stephen McKinley Henderson when I say this, you have to do it for the people, but on the art's terms. If I'm saying to you, if the community loves McDonald's, I say, okay, I'm gonna give you some burgers and some French fries. But it's gonna be pure Angus beef, it's gonna be Wagyu. The fries are gonna be fried in pure vegetable oil, not Crisco. So I'm gonna feed you, But I'm gonna feed you, I'm gonna give you something that can nourish you. And that's the art's terms. Because the art was there to uplift, was there to engage, was there to educate while we entertain. So I'm doing it for the people, but on the art's terms. And when we lose that, then we're nothing but jack-a-leg coons. when you lose that, not that need to give you something you can feel, give you something that you need, give you something that will nourish your soul, your spirit, that will uplift. You know what I'm saying? That's what that's supposed to be about. And so the thing is that we are doing it. It is happening. But I think that, again, we're in this transitional period where it's like we're trying to separate the real from the fake, the good from, you know what I mean? It's like, let's bring, what is qualitative? And what and how can we be do bring qualitative work while we still entertain instead of regressing back to what once was because we had to, hey, do we just happen to have a job? You know what I mean? So now we're here. So I hope that answers the question.
Yes, yes.
And I just want to say this has been great, Eddie. I really appreciate you inviting me on. Thank you.
Award-winning, multi-talented, critically acclaimed actor Russell Hornsby. Thank you for being open. Thank you for being vulnerable. Thank you for being honest. And thank you for being a guest on ICU.
Thank you, brother. My pleasure.
Our team includes technical director Todd Holzlander, producer Laura Walker, editors Mark DiClaudio and John Mitchell Good. ICU is a production of Houston Public Media. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter and subscribe to our podcast wherever you listen and download your favorite shows. I'm your host and executive producer, Eddie Robinson. And I feel you. We hear you. I see you. Thanks so much for listening. Until next time.